Pagi. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Waalaikumsalam. Selamat semua. Very good morning everyone. So today we have an honor to have Mr. Frank Mullen. He is a journalist from NRC Handelsblad, so one of the prominent newspaper in the Netherlands, and he has been part of this newspaper since I think 1987, if I'm not mistaken, right?
No.
Well, anyway, 88, okay. And has been in charge of political affairs, correspondent in Jakarta 1996, 2000, and then correspondent in Berlin 2012 and 2016, and then also internal writers. And he published several books. Two of them are The Rechtsstaat, Wir schaffen das, How the Migration Crisis is Affecting the German Mind, and then 2016, and then Over Indi, Memories of Indonesia in Colonial Time. His new coming book, titled Why Must You Had to Die, The Indonesian War, and Unusual Love Affair and Political Killing. Okay, so today we are going to listen to the experience of Mr. Frank Mullen when he was doing his job as a journalist, as correspondent in Jakarta. So we witnessed the turmoil period of Indonesian history, but basically what we call as the Reformasi movement in Jakarta in 1998. So the title of his talk today is Year of Living Dangerously, How I Witnessed the Downfall of Suharto in 1998. So this is actually a very important period in the modern Indonesian history, which is, we know it, it's just the step down of Suharto, but also the beginning of the so-called Reformasi era. And apparently, the event has been 25 years ago, so time flies very fast, and then this is very important event, but I don't think really, you know, like so many serious study has been done about this period. So today we are going to listen about the experience of Mr. Frank Mullen as a journalist, and also you can also learn how a journalist make a report about the political, you know, development in a country like Indonesia. Mr. Frank is not alone. He will be accompanied by Mas Ahmad Salman, or Mas Denny, is the photographer who worked with him during the period of time. So we will listen to really like a grounded report about what was happening in Jakarta in that period. And even Mr. Frank was there in Istana Negara when Suharto announced his, you know, his retirement or his withdrawal from the politics. So yeah, without a further ado, I will give you a floor, Frank. Maybe 20 minutes for talk, and then and also maybe later, Mas Denny will also tell his story from his point of view, and then after that we can have a question and answer. No worries, you can ask in Bahasa Indonesia because Pak Frank juga sangat baik dalam Bahasa Indonesia. So yeah, we feel free to ask a question later. Yeah, Frank, time is yours. Oh yeah, sure.
Thank you. Professor Wahid, thank you very much. I'm going to try to walk and read, because maybe it's a bit boring when I'm sitting up there and you're sitting down here. So, my text says, the reason why I wrote it down is because I've got some slides, but if I just talk about the slides, this will last 3 hours. This is a big event, so I had to be concise. So I wrote it down, I will read what I wrote down. So I would first like to thank Professor Wahid for inviting me here at the University of Guatemala, which I consider a big honor. That's not a cliche, but I really feel that. To tell you my story about the end of Orde Baru. By the way, for me it feels like a big adventure to put myself in the middle of a story. As a classical journalist, I'm trained to stay neutral, out of the story, observing, not taking part. And now is the question, of course, is that possible? But we will get to that later, maybe. So I thank you all for your attendance and ask you to join me in that adventure. Moreover, I would like to introduce to you my friend, Ahmed Salman, Danny, who was with me for a lot of time during the so-called Era Reformasi, a discussion partner, a source of information also, a photographer and a seasoned former activist from Bandung. He will share with you some of his observations during this period. And some remarks about this title that now has disappeared. The Year of Living Dangerously is, of course, a bad movie about the fall of Sukarno. But it's also, I use it also because it is founded in nonfiction. When I was in Kigolok in 1989, I went to the Kanteng and lots of Chinese people were praying and they were looking worried. So I asked them, what's the matter? And they said, it's the year of the tiger. And there are lots of tensions and we are afraid of what's going to happen. And they were right, of course. You know that, maybe. Slide two. 25 years ago today, this month, Indonesian military forces, then still called Angkatan Bersenjata Republik Indonesia, or ABRI, killed six students in or just outside Atmajaya campus near Semanggi Cloverleaf Passover in the center of Jakarta. Also, 11 civilians were killed. I was inside the campus of the 13th of November and wrote in my newspaper, November the 14th, quote, troops of the mobile brigade are already for 2 hours shooting at the campus. Now I turn over the page. I didn't practice that. With rubber bullets, tear gas, and stun grenades, but every salvo, every grenade that explodes is greeted with an overwhelmingly furious uproar of hundreds of students taking cover inside the campus. End of quote. Slide three. This is the mother of economy student Bernardus Rialino Norma Mirawan Orwawan, Ibu Suwarsi. Maybe you know her because afterwards she became a one-person action committee. I saw his body in Jakarta Hospital after the shooting. I was impressed by the enormous courage of these young people. Revolusi atau mati was not just a slogan, it was real. And I remember that I also reported live from the scene on Dutch Radio 1. I also worked for radio by that time. With my Nokia communicator, a hyper-modern handphone, then he will remember at that time that you could also send faxes with, which now sounds weird because a fax is, of course, something you don't think about when you don't hear a smartphone. As the radio anchorwoman heard the shooting on the background, she said, "Please take care of yourself, Frank." And that's when I realized that I had felt invulnerable all the time, because of the phone on my ear that connected me with the studio in the Netherlands and the idea that I was just a bystander who didn't take part in this conflict. Slide four. Oh, it's already there. Within a year, it would become painfully clear how this was a form of dangerous self-deception. I will come to that at the end of this talk. But first, we must back up the tape. This violence took place in November 1989, so a half year after Suharto stepped down on the May 21st of that year. Of course, I could have also told this story by starting at the beginning, but the beginning of historical events is always up for debate, and being a newspaper journalist, I gave in to the temptation to connect this history with the present day. And before I start, I would like to make first, like a brief, some brief remarks on the essence of history and its relation to journalism. Hello. That's a poster of the movie, The Years of Living Dangerously, bad movie, but it's entertaining. Two famous historians of this university, Professor Bambang Purwanto and Professor Abdul Wahid, have recently cooperated in the Dutch-Indonesian initiative to shed more light on the Indonesian Revolution. Professor Purwanto stressed in his introduction to the volume Our Revolution the remarkable plasticity of historiography, be it Dutch or Indonesian. And one could perhaps say that Professor Wahid expanded that notion of historiographical plasticity in the introduction to the volume Revolutionary Worlds. He wrote together with Rolf Racking, quote, "This volume aims to reinsert the complexity in an otherwise oversimplified interpretation of the 1945-49 period that holds sway both in the Netherlands and Indonesia. The Indonesian Revolution was a highly multifaceted event constricted and shaped by actors representing different political, religious, social, and regional entities." You still there? End of quote. So, history can be simplified or be made more complex. That's what I meant with plasticity or pliancy. The next, please. The relevance of this excursion is that historical pliancy is also applicable to the newest history of Indonesia. Can you read that one? It says, "Escalator Pertama di Indonesia sejak 1966, the first health escalator in Indonesia." I do not need to tell you that writing history is a serious business. As you can see, according to the famous Sarina warehouse in Jakarta, 1966, was an important year for Indonesia because that was the first, then was the first escalator introduced. I need not say, it was perhaps even more important that on March the 11th of that year, Sukarno de facto transferred his power by decree to Lieutenant General Suharto, as you all know, by signing the Surat Perintah 11 Maret, or Super Sumar. It was a dark period marked by killings of thousands of people who were suspected of being part of a communist failed coup on September the 30th in 1965. In terms of history writing, this remains until this day a sensitive matter, just like the violent colonial war is in the Netherlands. But it was nevertheless the time that Suharto came to power. So here we have a possible beginning of my story. Suharto installed Orde Baru and became father of economic growth, Bapak Pembangunan. And he looked like that. Masih ingat, ya? He also oversaw a repressive and corrupt regime. I admit this is an unhistorical and partial opinion. That expelled political prisoners or TAPL, annexed Timor-Leste, and committed human rights violations, as we now would say in the Netherlands, structural violence, from Papua to Aceh. By the middle of the 90s, this system had become worn out. This was the time I became correspondent in Indonesia to deliver my contribution to the so-called first draft of history, as journalism is often called. As I landed in Jakarta by the end of 1969, I bought a metal filing cabinet to start an archive, and I started working on expanding my network. An archive and a network are instrumental to all research. My biggest problem, I thought, would be how to get in. How could I reach sources of information in a country without freedom of press and without freedom of expression? That fear quickly disappeared because the internet at the time made a revolutionary breakthrough called Windows 95. All NGOs gave their take on reality on my screen. Indonesian ministries, media, and news agencies started using the internet. My PC solved all initial problems. Plus, the mobile telephone was here already in general in use, so sources were only a text message away. Meantime, I had been reading A Nation in Waiting by Adam Swartz, who predicted the inevitable downfall of the dictator, which was unimaginable at that time, because he was already 30 years there. On the other hand, there was my predecessor, who warned me that I should not expect anything. Suharto wasn't going anywhere soon, he said. At first, I thought my predecessor was right. Suharto was on TVRI every day, smiling, shaking hands, waving and playing golf with his cronies, Bob Hassan and Omni. His children, Tutut, Bambam and Tommy. Were daily news and in charge of large business corporations. And of course, there was the second daughter, Titi, who was married to a general in charge of Copassus, the special forces, with who were infamous because of their brutal operations in Timor Aceh in Papua. His name was Prabowo Subianto. An interesting name. I don't know if we get into that later, but in the question time. This was the time I covered stories about relentless fires in the peat soil in Kalimantan that blackened the skies above Singapore. I flew to Balikpapan, traveled up the river, spoke to the people who were suffering from food shortage, or I wrote about the Freeport McMoRan mine in Papua. I went to Timika, saw the destruction of the mountain formerly known as Grasberg, Grass Mountain, and the ecological disaster that was in the estuary in the valley below. I spoke to local Papua chief Tom Beyanal, who was furious. I traveled to East Java, arrived with violence. There had been reports of Ninja killings at the night. People driving around on motorcycles brandishing heads of their victims. Of course, I only encountered very sweet residents who felt terrorized but couldn't give any information about who was behind this. Pundits in Jakarta suggested this was all staged by elites on the background. There was no way to check these rumors, so you could only quote the pundits. Back in Jakarta, you had to watch out for the information ministry. This was a form of censorship or intimidation. Department Penerangan could take away your working permit. One day I was invited by the chief, whose name I have forgotten, to come to the office. I saw a room filled with people reading Dutch media, to my surprise. And they were making clippings. The head showed me the cover of a Dutch magazine. On it was Suharto and some negative comments. He scolded me about that cover. But what could I do? I had nothing to do with that magazine. Then he said I was supposed to see his remark as a friendly warning. This whole office filled with civil servants would become superfluous. Because of era reformatie, censorship was cancelled. But at that time, I did not know that. But of course, there were secret agents also, Intel, who were monitoring Jung, or just stood there openly making notes, intimidation tactics. In July 1979, this is my newspaper, by the way, I was on holidays with my family in Bali. Something happened that changes everything. From Thailand came reports about the crash of the pad in Thailand. At the time, I thought, okay, something to write about when I'm back. Of course, you can conclude that I'm not really an economic genius because this was the start of the so-called Asian financial crisis. All the countries in Southeast Asia that had called themselves proudly tiger economies because of their remarkable economic performances went bust. By the time we got home from Bali, the rupiah had devalued dramatically. Later, unemployment rose sky high. This was Krismon, this is Monetaire. Suddenly, everyone was in trouble, so it seemed, apart from people with dollar accounts. But even in the well-to-do suburbs of Jakarta, like Kebayoran Baru, people planted papaya and sikong in their gardens and everybody started the food stall. Later that year, I was for a short visit in Holland. CNN showed people plundering macro stores in Jakarta, mainly looking for baby milk. The same night, I was on the plane back to Jakarta. Students started demonstrating, first inside their campuses because it was forbidden to go outside. But I also visited farmers and factory workers who were fed up. Their anger rose with the rise of the prices of solar. Slowly it became clear that the pressure on Suharto must have been enormous.
there were kidnappings of student activists. And, sorry, spoiler, later Prabowo admitted that he was behind these abductions. 13 students are still missing, up to this day. Then came May 1989. It became clear that the unrest wasn't confined to Jakarta. For instance, I went to Medan, where students were fighting against security forces. They stayed inside their campus, but that was the first time I saw security personnel take aim and try to hit protesters. By shooting at them with tear gas canisters, I had to take cover behind some trees. Students handed me wet cloths to dampen the effect of the gas and toothpaste to put, that's a tip anyway for you all, to put around your eyes. I'm not sure it helps, but it looks spectacular. Did you use the toothpaste, Professor? Did you use the toothpaste to dampen the effect of the tear gas?
Yes.
After that, I received a message in the morning from a student that something terrible had happened at Trisakti University. It was May the 12th. While students were leaving the campus to protest outside the boundaries of university, sharpshooters had killed 6 of them. And now the whole city was filled with furious students. They called for an end to KKN, corruptie, collusie, nepotisme. Also something to remember. They sang songs about ABRI, Angkatan Bersenjata Republik Indonesia, etc. Ayo sekolah. That's what ABRI will something. Okay, so it was very, very happy time. They sang songs in the center of Jakarta, and I was observing the fracas as I was observing the fracas on Sudirman Boulevard. Suddenly, I was surprised by a peloton of armed police or soldiers. I was mortally scared. I'd never been in that situation, of course. So I squatted in the grass behind a thin tree with my press card in the air, feeling quite silly, but also scared. But nothing happened. These army and policemen were obviously instructed not to harm foreign press, and they were very professional. You may have read about what happened next. Student marched to the parliament buildings. And eventually the gates were opened, and thousands of students marched in. There was euphoria. They were everywhere. On the roof, in the offices, shattering documents through the open windows. Glodok, the Chinese business district in downtown Jakarta, was meanwhile sacked by thugs. Chinese women were raped, stores were plundered. Hundreds of people who were plundering warehouses or malls that were set to fire burned to death. I reported from this from my house in South Jakarta. My wife happened to be in Holland. I brought our two sons to the house of Herman, the CEO of Multibintang, who I knew, of course. His compound was better protected against possible harm than the place I lived. And after a day or two, Bintang organized a passenger plane to evacuate people to Singapore. I could also go along with my sons. In my car was Herman's neighbor, who was of Chinese descent, with one of her sons. Her husband and their other son were in the car before us, risk spreading. We drove in a short motorcade to Soekarno-Hatta Airport, passing a few roadblocks with army tanks, but no harm came to us from rioters. We flew out to Singapore, where my wife in the meantime had arrived. By the next day, I returned to Jakarta, where I received a message on the morning of the 21st of May to come to the presidential palace. Meanwhile, it became clear that Suharto's ministers no longer supported the president. So I remember hurrying to the palace through the empty business district of Jakarta. No manchette that day. On Jalan Gajah Mada, the road to Blolok, in my memory, people were still busy carrying stuff out of the shops. Armed military at the crossroads just looked on and did nothing. I was together with two Dutch colleagues, one also a correspondent, the other one was flown in by National Radio 1. Jakarta correspondents were all briefed about how to dress and to behave inside the palace. Our Dutch colleague was not, so he was wearing sandals, which was forbidden. We warned him, but he declared autonomously that nobody needed to tell him how to dress. A reminder for me of the less attractive sides of Dutch character. Because of his stubbornness, we all three had to wait until he organized proper shoes. After that, we were guided to one of the smaller halls in front of the palace. There were already 40 or 50 journalists thrown together on the left side of the room, behind an arch of TV cameras in front. In the end, everything happened very fast. That's what I wrote next day in the newspaper. You see the President Suharto in the middle and the members of the Supreme Court and Habibie next to him. 10 years later, I was back in Jakarta when Suharto died. Looking back, I wrote, quote, "Suharto seemed overly tired that morning. The ceremony looked a bit improvised. According to the rules, the president was supposed to stand down in parliament. But that was impossible because it was still being occupied by thousands of students. Suharto stood down and his vice president Habibi was sworn in. Members of the Supreme Court standing in behind him were supposed to give the ceremony a semblance of worthiness. After a 30-year rule, the mightiest man of this country with more than 200 million inhabitants eventually stepped down. World news. After the short speech of Suharto, I stepped outside into the marvelous white pillar gallery of this former palace of the Dutch Gouverneur-Generaal and brought the news through my mobile phone to the listeners of Radio 1 in Holland. Probably around 8 nurses, 9 nurses, so early in the morning in the Netherlands. I don't think many people have heard my reports about this world news. The last detail I mentioned in my report a day later in the newspaper was that Suharto's car, the numbers changed from RI Satu to a normal Jakarta number plate. He was instantly become a normal citizen. At the parliamentary building, students celebrated their victory. I expected that also the citizens of Jakarta in the small neighborhoods would be euphoric. But to my surprise, they felt pity for Suharto. Kasiapa Harto, they told me. Now I will leave out everything that happened the next year, next in that year, and jump to September 23rd in 1999. Again, one student and 11 civilians were shot near Samangi during demonstrations by students and civilians. This time, because the new president, Habibi, wanted to give the army, now called TNI, special authorities in emergency situations. The crowd was also angry because a short time before, East Timor voted for autonomy in a referendum, and because Australia had sent peace forces to end the senseless violence in that island. People were especially angry with the Australians on the street. Yes, that's slide 12. I don't know if you can see what's going on in this picture. It's a picture of Sander Toenis, who was shot dead. My friend and colleague Sander Toenis was shot dead by Indonesian trained militia. I lost my belief that we journalists were just bystanders. I was going back to the Netherlands also because I no longer felt an outsider. To the conflict. But I was there on Sudirman Boulevard to introduce my successor to Radio 1 and everyone to the city. Coming from Bundaran HI, we saw the crowd at Samangi, so I decided to keep distance. But then the whole crowd shifted in our direction. They were chasing two Australian journalists who I knew, and suddenly we're in the middle of it. There were hands everywhere taking my phone, my sunglasses, but there were also other men in the melee, now I would say plainclothes agents, who guided us under the fence of the out of the crowd towards two objects who brought us back to Hotel Mandarin unharmed. Dear students, ending a story is just as difficult as finding a beginning, but let me try one possible ending. Of course, you're all familiar to Plato's cave, roughly the philosophical idea that we are not capable of seeing reality because we are all sitting inside a cave, looking at the wall, and what we call reality are in fact shadows of the real world. I know it's a cliché, like comparing Indonesian politics to Maya, but reading Yusuf Anandi's Shades of Grey, published 10 years ago, about all things that were supposed to have been going on behind the screens in 1989, you realize that we as journalists and maybe historians pay attention. And now we could maybe first, then we could tell his story. Next.
Yes, silakan Mas Zura, Mas Denny. Thank you so much, Frank. Ya, silakan Mas Denny.
Saya akan menambahkan sedikit dari apa yang disampaikan oleh Frank. Frank tadi secara personal ya, dari sudut point of view-nya dia sebagai jurnalis. Saya juga menggunakan point of view saya, tapi dengan sedikit konteks. Bisa mulai dengan saya pertama. Oh ya, kalau Frank berusaha menjadi netral sebagai jurnalis, saya sama sekali tidak netral itu. Karena saya sangat ingin Soeharto jatuh. Dan saya waktu itu saya belum benar-benar menjadi jurnalis, saya sebagai aktivis. Ya. Saya bahkan meninggalkan pekerjaan, berkeliling-keliling kota membangun jaringan dalam bulan-bulan itu untuk menyatukan teman-teman mahasiswa yang waktu itu masih tercerai-berai gitu ya, untuk menunda perselisihan, perbedaan, dan menerima dulu kita sebut sekultura, 10 tuntutan rakyat yang kemudian nantinya menjadi betul-betul turunkan harga awalnya, kemudian menjadi turunkan Harto dan keluarga. Itu hanya dalam beberapa bulan itu saya bergerak, saya meninggalkan pekerjaan, saya bersyukur waktu itu bos saya almarhum Munir di LBH mengizinkan saya cuti permanen dan tetap digaji, bahwa cak, saya harus bergerak, nggak bisa di kantor, ini waktunya aja. Ya udah tetap digaji, tapi kalau di Jakarta ngantor dulu ya, kerjaan jangan bisa mengerjakan kerjaan. Nah ini saya memberikan konteks ini. Ya, ini terjadi, ini adalah kalau orang sakit demam, ini ada kurva suhunya gitu, suhu tubuhnya. Ini adalah nilai tukar rupiah dolar. Ya, awal Juli 97 itu dolar masih 2.500. Tadi Frank pergi ke Bali, dolar masih segitulah ya. Nah, itu Desember, Januari itu gila, udah 18 ribuan, 6 kali lipat lebih. Dan itu betul-betul terjadi, ya ilustrasinya, susu, formula yang dibilang oleh Frank, ibu-ibu, wah di mana-mana susah mencari susu. Kebetulan waktu itu saya juga punya keponakan umur beberapa bulan, ibunya menangis-nangis karena sulit mencari susu. Sekaleng 26-28 ribu, ya itu Desember itu udah nggak bisa didapat, harganya udah 150-200 ribu, 6 kali lipat, kurang lebih sama dengan nilai rupiah yang Juli 2600, Desember yang curam sekali itu sekitar 16-18 ribu. Anda harus cek periksa untuk mengetahui angka detailnya, karena itu berubah sesuai jam dan hari. Jadi kurang lebih itulah ya konteks Juli ketika suhu politik memanas sampai Soeharto jatuh di Mei, ya, fluktuasi makroekonomi kita cilakanya, ini saya kutuk mereka para ekonom waktu itu, semua bilang kompak, fundamental ekonomi kita bagus, tidak usah khawatir. Sembari mereka melakukan hedging atau gampangnya menukarkan rupiah mereka ke dolar, sehingga banyak orang yang tidak sadar dan percaya pada fundamental ekonomi kita nggak siap, dan itu betul-betul 6 bulan yang menurut saya paling menyedihkan dalam hidup saya. Nah, ini saya selalu tahu orang-orang miskin itu mengemis, 1, 2 orang, 3 orang. Tidak di Desember 97 itu sampai Mei, karena ini adalah untuk orang yang ngantri makan gratis, makan siang. Saya tidak pernah melihat orang ratusan ngantri untuk bisa makan siang. Nah, itu mereka bawa sendok, tertidur, karena makan siangnya jam 12-an, mereka datang udah jam 10, takut nggak kebagian. Dan karena lapar, mereka hanya bisa tidur. Itu di Jakarta ada beberapa tempat, ya, orang-orang yang dari yayasan yang melakukan aksi charity, apa, kemanusiaan gitu ya, 200-300 orang tiap hari makan siang, gratis. Nah, ini gambaran tadi ekonomi yang melapak, dolar yang melejit. Kantor-kantor, gedung-gedung itu kosong, orang nggak sanggup lagi nyewa. Kuncinya dikembalikan, ruangannya kosong, ya. Terus kantor-kantor yang kosong kehilangan tenan penyewa itu disewakan jam-jaman atau harian dengan biaya murah untuk perawatan kepada mantan-mantan karyawan untuk bikin basar. Nah, jadi cara mereka supaya kehilangan pekerjaan, ya bikin basar. Basar apa aja? Nah itu di bekas-bekas kantor di gedung-gedung tinggi di Sudirman Tamrin itu, ya. Suasana di dalamnya kurang lebih kayak gitu, ya. Nah, alat-alat berat dan sebagainya, lukisan-lukisan sudah dilelang. Mereka tuh nggak ada cash lagi, ya. Jadi mereka melakukan lelang. Itu saya memotret suasana lelang. Ini tukang lelangnya tuh palunya jatuh di bawah. Menyedihkan sekali buat saya, sampai palu untuk ngetok harganya terjatuh, ya. Saya kebetulan di belakangnya, ya. Jadi gedung-gedung kosong, udah nggak sanggup lagi nyewa apa ruangan per meter berapa dolar, nggak sanggup. Ya, lanjut lagi, ya. Nah, itu mobil dulu Mercy itu simbol lah, ya, simbol kekayaan. Ya. Mereka sampai yang punya gitu nyewa mariner dan sebagainya untuk jaga Mercy-nya. Pada takut dijarah dan sebagainya. Resto-resto juga pada menyingkirkan meja-mejanya. Gambarnya sesuram itu. Nah, kemudian lagi, ini lucu nih, paket hemat. Ini dikenalkan gara-gara Kresko. Dulu ada satu namanya Kurs, McDonald atau apa namanya. Ada burgernya yang harganya $1. Big Mac itu di mana-mana harganya $1. Itu jadi semacam nilai kurs. Jadi kurs juga bahasa populernya kan kadang kita rupiah terhadap dolar berapa, rupiah terhadap Big Mac berapa. Bayangin Big Mac Juli itu masih hanya 2.800. Desember tuh udah kalau ngikutin dolar nggak ada yang beli. Maka diperkenalkanlah namanya paket hemat. Itu pernah gara-gara Richmond itu, sehingga Big Mac masih bisa standing lah, apa McDonald itu orang-orang masih yang beli meskipun sudah 4 kali lipat, sebetulnya sudah 10 ribuan, 11 ribuan. Ini ilustrasi dari situasi itu, ya. Bagaimana orang-orang di dalam yang sanggup beli, ya beli makan enjoy aja, baca koran, yang di luar itu sedih, yang jualan koran pengen gitu, ya. Ini gambaran kontras sosial waktu itu. Itu saya memotret dari dalam McDonald's ke arah luar. Ya. Nah, yang berikutnya, dari luar ke dalam. Suasana mereka yang sanggup beli, happy ya, nggak apa, sama aja hidup kayak asik-asik aja. Ya, pacaran, berciuman. Nah, itu suasana kebebasan mulai muncul. Orang-orang pada berciuman di tempat umum, udah pada bandel ya anak-anak muda. Padahal seharusnya belum turun benar. Tapi mereka udah lebih anak-anak muda pede gitu.
Oke, lanjut lagi.
Nah, ini dari tempat parkir. Bagaimana orang itu dia ngemis pengen, tapi karena nggak bisa berkomunikasi dengan yang di dalam, kan kacanya tebal tuh McDonald's, ya kan? Akhirnya dia hanya menghirup bau dari dapur itu. Apa ngapain Pak? Ambune enak. Saya sedih akhirnya saya kasih dia, saya beli dia burger satu. Jadi ini ilustrasi aja waktu itu bagaimana suasana tadi ya. Orang-orang kehilangan pekerjaan, kantor apa, ruang-ruang kantor pada tutup, PHK dan sebagainya. Nah, ketika akan lebih bilang setelah penembakan di tanggal 11, 12, tanggal 14, mahasiswa masuk DPR-DPR. Saya bersama seorang dosen UI sekarang, dulu masih sama-sama aktivis mahasiswa, kamilah yang pertama menurunkan bendera setengah tiang di gedung DPR, karena poster nggak mengizinkan tuh bendera turunkan karena mahasiswa marah, mereka berduka temannya ditembak, akhirnya ditodong 8 senjata, saya dan jajar tuh nekat turunin bendera, dan begitu bendera turun setengah tiang mahasiswa jebol, memaksa masuk dan tentara mengizinkan mereka dan rusak 14. Saya rasa saya hanya menambahkan itu saja tadi, terutama soal grafik suhu Indonesia tadi dari 2600 ke 18.000 balik di 11-an 12.000 ketika Soeharto turun nih. Saya tahu Soeharto akan turun jam 5 pagi sebelum dia itu, karena ada pertemuan, ada Yusril. Yusril sudah membocorkan rahasia bahwa dia akan gerak pernyataan pengunduran diri Soeharto. Saya mendapatkannya kabar itu lewat almarhum Gus Dur. Dia waktu itu tanda petik pemimpin saya, dia ketua forum demokrasi. Saya membuat posko di tak jauh dari istana untuk posko informasi, keliling informasi mana perlu dilanjutkan ke mahasiswa, mana perlu ditahan, mana perlu difilter. Gitu. Ya, saya bertugas di posko itu jam 5 pagi. Gus Dur beritahu, Dek, kita menang. Berikut Gus, Soeharto mundur. Wanti-wanti adik-adik di Senayan, jangan terprovokasi kalau ada ngajak musuh. Pasti nih Gus, yo. Jam 5.10 betul. Ya. Kemudian saya telepon beberapa teman wartawan, dan terutama teman-teman yang berjuang di luar negeri, kelompok teman-teman yang di Belanda dan sebagainya, mengabarkan bahwa akan ada 1-2 jam ini kabar yang penting, ikutin aja. Saya tidak berani menyebutkan Soeharto dulu, tapi saya menyebutkan yang penting. Itu salah satunya, kamu itu sekarang yang bertugas bersama saya sekarang jadi ngajar di sini, namanya Tri Agus. Itu saya berdua sama dia jaga posko pagi itu jam 5.10 lah. Gus Dur memberitahu. Saya rasa itu saja ya, tambahan dari saya. Nanti silakan berkembang yang berkembangkan atau yang ingin tahu dalam tanya jawab. Terima kasih Pak Profesor.
Terima kasih Mas Deli. Baik teman-teman, kita sudah mendengarkan dua paparan tadi dari Bapak Pran dan juga Mas Denny, melengkapi dari sisi visual fotografi tentang proses yang berjalan ataupun urut-urutan peristiwa yang terjadi sebelum, ketika dan sesudah turunnya Pak Harto di tahun 1998 Mei ya. Jadi sebenarnya ini kebanyakan yang cerita tentang apa yang terjadi di Jakarta. sebenarnya juga di daerah pada waktu itu, pada kurang lebih waktu yang sama juga suhu politik meningkat. Demonstrasi juga terjadi besar-besaran di beberapa kota, di Jawa terutama, tapi juga di luar Jawa saya kira. Yogyakarta termasuk juga yang sangat aktif waktu itu. Ya, dan kebetulan saya ada di periode itu jadi mahasiswa, dan mau tidak mau ya kalau waktu itu demonstrasi ikut demo itu SKS-nya 10 lah kayak gitu. Harusnya membolehkan ya gitu untuk demo kayak gitu. Karena kalau nggak membolehkan ya akan jadi bumerang sendiri kayak gitu. Jadi di Yogyakarta terjadi juga peristiwa Sagan, peristiwa Kejayan, kemudian juga Pasewaran Agung yang kemudian 1 juta orang berkumpul di depan keraton gitu di alun-alun Yogyakarta. Waktu itu memberikan message ke Jakarta, tapi di Jakarta suasana tentu lebih dramatis ya. Jadi konteks besarnya adalah kemunduran ataupun runtuhnya kepercayaan publik terhadap pemerintahan Soeharto dimulai ketika krisis ekonomi yang terjadi itu tidak bisa ditanggulangi. Ya, jadi itu menunjukkan fundamental ekonomi tadi yang digadang-gadang, yang diklaim fundamentalnya kuat ternyata keropos. Jadi itu yang kemudian membuka banyak hal, termasuk salah satunya adalah ini disebabkan karena takutnya KKN. Saya kayak gitu, bahwa aset ekonomi atau perekonomian hanya ada di sekeliling elit saja. Dan hanya di Indonesia, krisis ekonomi berkepanjangan dan kemudian berubah menjadi krisis politik. Bahkan kemudian disebut sebagai krisis total. Dari krismon menjadi krispol, menjadi kristal. Tapi setelah itu puncaknya runtuhnya Soeharto. Tapi itu pun sebenarnya berada di luar perkiraan. Karena inginnya adalah semua rezim ini turun, tapi kemudian hanya Pak Hartonya saja. Dan dilimpahkan kepada Habibie. Jadi ada hal yang berbeda lah kayak gitu. Tapi Pak Frank juga melanjutkan ceritanya sedikit, karena kemudian pada era Habibie, karena mungkin Habibie ingin menunjukkan perbedaannya dengan Pak Harto, dia dengan berani kemudian menyetujui referendum dan melepaskan Timor Leste kayak gitu. Dan itu menjadi krisis politik yang lain, tapi itu yang lebih banyak terjadi di Timor-Timor kayak gitu. Tapi story-nya akan berkait dengan figur yang sangat penting hari ini yang calon presiden kayak gitu. Anyway, kita sudah menerangkan banyak hal dan mengungkapkan banyak fakta, juga menghidupkan ingatan tentang periode ini dan peristiwa ini. Silakan teman-teman kalau ingin bertanya banyak tentang periode ini, boleh tentang apa yang dikaitkan dengan tadi yang disampaikan Pak Frank maupun juga Mas Denny, atau juga hal yang lain yang terkait dengan itu. Mas, apa, Marvin, satu, ada lagi sebentar. Kita ambil 3 lah kayak gitu. Tamim, oke, Mas. Silakan, Mas.
Perkenalkan nama saya Raffian Rabu, biasa dipanggil Vian. Saya ingin menanyakan, dan ada satu hal yang berkaitan dengan proses reformasi, di mana pers di Indonesia, terutama di ranah pertelevisian itu ikut andil dalam proses reformasi. Bermula dari tragedi Trisakti tahun 1998. Akhirnya ditanggapi oleh DC Anwar yang kali itu mengabdi untuk RCTI dengan mengenakan pita hitam di lengan kiri sebagai tanda duka. Nah, beliau alumni salah satu anggota alumni UI. Hal itu mengundang tanggapan bagi beberapa anggota alumni UI lainnya untuk mengenakan pita hitam yang sama, tetapi diprotes oleh petinggi RCTI saat itu. Begitupun TVRI yang mengambil kebijakan TV pool, tetapi ANTV menyikapi hal kebijakan itu dengan keberatan melalui pembentangan spanduk yang tulisannya TV pool no, swimming pool yes. Dan yang paling terkenal itu yang dari SCTV, di mana Ibu Ira Kusno yang kali itu pengampu acara liputan 6 siang edisi 17 Mei 1998 mewawancarai almarhum Sarwono Kusuma Atmaja. Beliau, Pak Sawono Kusuma Atmaja, ternyata buat analogi pasca tragedi Trisakti, di mana peristiwa itu dianalogikan dengan cabut gigi yang memang diartikan dengan desakan pengunduran diri atas Pak Harto, sedangkan tanggal gigi itu dianalogikan dengan rencana perombakan atau reshuffle Kabinet Pembangunan Jilid ke-7 yang selanjutnya jadi Kabinet Reformasi Pembangunan. Nah, makanya ditangga. Tetapi di akhir acara langsung diselesaikan karena Bu Sumita Nuban Toping yang kala itu tim Red SCTV langsung dipecat. Sedangkan Bu Tumpas Pasamun yang sekarang di Metro TV itu diskorsing. Dan lanjut lagi dan akhirnya berbuat tanggapan dari Pak Harmoko yang menanggapi kok Pak Antos sebaiknya mengundurkan diri dan akhirnya langsung diliput oleh RCTI yang saat itu pengampunya Bu Dani Suara. Dan ada lagi rencana pengundurkan diri akhirnya disiarkan pertama kali oleh Indosiar. Dan proses pergerakan TV swasta tadi apakah memang terkait erat dengan proses reformasi?
So it's about televisions, yes. A lot of televisions. Yes. But extend, you're also involved in the process, in the movement. Sorry. Yeah, in the movement, or they will also contribute.
Hello.
I didn't understand everything you said, but I got the impression that you asked me about the role of the Indonesian media, especially TVRI.
TVRI.
Of course, during the Suharto time, I will answer in English because my Indonesian is not so good as yours. There was, I remember only like a few TV. Yeah. And TVRI, of course, was very much the voice of the state. That's why you always saw there the presidential family. You could look at all these television broadcast companies as a way of knowing how the government was looking at things. You immediately know it wasn't independent, but there were independent journalists, IG. Union of Independent Journalists, and they were active, and they were also in contact with foreign correspondents, and of course there was a change of culture also amongst Indonesian journalists. I can illustrate that. Before Reformasi, I once went to a press conference in one of the ministries with all my Indonesian colleagues also. I don't know where what it was about, but I remember afterwards, I thought they were all going to one corner of the room and they were handed envelopes. I thought these are the press text messages about the news that is being spread here, and then they were a bit ashamed. They said, "No, it's not for you. This is one pakir, that's one envelope." So that was.
It's money.
Yes, it was parking money. It was money to also, of course, implicate journalists not to be too critical. Afterward, I didn't see that again. And instead, everybody became a critical journalist. And maybe that lasted not for very long. I didn't follow it after 1999. But Danny knows a lot about this matter.
Okay. Penembakan Trisakti itu terjadi sekitar jam 9 pagi. Dan Trisakti waktu itu memiliki radio FM yang luar biasa aktif mensupport gerakan mahasiswa. Nah, waktu penembakan itu sedang terjadi siaran oleh seseorang mahasiswa UI yang sekarang menjadi ketua Komnas HAM, namanya Agnike Sigiro. Ya. Dia dengan menangis menceritakan itu apa yang dia lihat dari agak ketinggian di Trisakti sana, ya, tentang itu, ya. Dan ini didengarkan oleh orang-orang Jakarta. Yang merespon pertama dan kemudian ini menjadi luar biasa adalah radio FM tetangga kami, Klasik Rock FM. Ya, kami tinggal di neighborhood, di dekat sekali, itu M97. Ya, gila itu penyiarnya, tiba-tiba radionya jadi Penny Black lagunya, dan seruan setengah tiang, terus-terusan sepanjang hari 24 jam. Ini hari pertama pas penembakan itu, Mas. Ya, wartawan sebelumnya tak berani, hanya siaran-siaran demo, footage-footage gitu. Ya. Justru dimulai dari radio. Radio Trisakti sendiri, kemudian hanya selisih berapa jam, M97 ini lebih berpengaruh buat kita di Jakarta, audiensnya anak-anak juga yang lebih anti status quo gitu ya, dengan selera musik itu ya. M97, aduh, saya tinggal satu komplek dengan radio ini, sama friend hanya 150 meter paling ya. M97 di Jalan Borobudur ya. Dan itu tadi, seruan untuk setengah tiang itu datang dari radio ini. Plus kemudian teman-teman Haji seperti dibilang oleh Frank melakukan gerilya ya, kemana-mana, termasuk tadi untuk mengenakan pita hitam. Jadi makanya tadi saya juga sama memaksa masuk menurunkan bendera ya, karena maksudnya adalah membawa orang-orang berduka. Dan itu responnya luar biasa ya. Begitu mahasiswa masuk siang, sore itu ibu-ibu udah datang nganter kue, nganter makanan, nganter apa aja gitu. Individual datang dari masyarakat Jakarta. Tadi nambahin Pak Profesor, betul, yang pertama masuk menguasai bergerak luar biasa itu Padang. Mahasiswa Padang itu sudah mendahului sore itu menguasai gedung DPR. Itu yang pertama, dan itu juga yang saya gunakan untuk memicu, mengirim kabar ke teman-teman di daerah, termasuk kelompok Jogja dan sebagainya, untuk mempercepat konsolidasi dan menguasai gubernuran atau DPRD. Ya, jadi tanggal 12 sampai 14, Jakarta justru terakhir sebetulnya, bukan terakhir benar ya, tapi yang jadi gong lah, karena yang dikuasai DPR-MPR kan gedungnya. Teman-teman di daerah 9 provinsi waktu itu, seingat saya, ya, dimulai dari Padang, Semarang dan sebagainya itu, mereka bergerak duluan menguasai DPR-DPRD itu. Itu saya rasa itu
adalah because I was thinking now, now it's coming back. Journalists on television, state television, have to be very careful. And the one who was really doing something, the weather guy, you know, he was saying things like, "This is good weather to go out demonstrating today." And it was like his advice. And every morning when we went out in the car to go to the protests. Danny and Eric Passetti, another photographer, and me. We listened to the rock radio, and they, let me see if it works. They had this, always. Song is Rubber Bullets. So this was also rock radio too, because they were shooting with rubber bullets. By the way, Abhi said they shot with rubber bullets, but they in fact also shot with sharp bullets.
Okay, gitu ya, Mas Fian. Jadi tambahannya kita anggap betul. Jadi ada peran yang sangat penting juga dari media televisi, meskipun televisi dalam hal itu kan ada empat ya, udah ada televisi swasta, ada CTS TV dan Indosiar. Ya, oke, ada 5 televisi swasta yang memberanikan diri kayak gitu. Ya, oke. Ya, itu sudah ditulis, dijelaskan, terima kasih informnya oleh Ishadi SK dalam bukunya Televisi dan Kekuasaan. Ishadi SK adalah mantan direktur TVRI. Ya, baik. Nah, oke. Okay. Ya, ada berikutnya.
Oke, I think set is pretty good, right? I don't have to stand. So it's okay. Thank you. Anyway, thank you for your presentation, Pak Frank and Pak Denny. Saya Kamil Mahidianto, undergraduate student from History Department, Universitas Gajah Mada. Would like to asking maybe to like two or three questions. But before that, I think it's really fascinating. Both of you showed us a different perspective and about the same event. We can talk about in journalist way or in the activist way. I found it really interesting. So I would like to ask Pak Frank, from your perspective and observation, how's the response from the Netherlands media outlet, especially from yours, and also like, because I think it's equally important, like the Reformation thing, like happening in Indonesia and Netherlands, like they have a long relationship. Also, maybe you can give us some tips how to read a photo, like a journalist photo, and also how to contextualize in a historically way about like the historical event, like how to interpret it, your photo or maybe like the other journalist photo, like that. Maybe you get it what I say, is it?
Yes, well, as I said in my talk, I work for NRC Handelsblad. It's a paper newspaper, but I also had an extra job for radio, because the newspaper is there every day, and so I can see they it's a reflection of how important people view a certain subject, and I can say that the Era Reformatie was in Holland one of the things that were closely watched by lots of people. My stories often ended up on the front page, and my work for radio became very intensive. In every news bulletin, they switched to Jakarta, and I was telling them, the listeners, live what was happening then in Jakarta. People wanted to know that in Holland. So you're right about this historical connection that still functioned. Maybe still, but I'm not sure how it is now, because now we have got one generation further. The second part of your question I forgot. It was about
how to read your photo, like a journalist photo, and how to contextualize with historically way, I guess. Like,
about photography.
Yeah.
Of course, that's not really my métier. I'm a writer, but. But then he is, I say it must, then he
bagaimana menjawabnya? Begini, di koran ada editor foto, ya. NRC editor fotonya bagus sekali, ya. Ketika saya beberapa kali bekerja, terjadi komunikasi, ya. Pertama, mereka mengecek fakta, memastikan caption yang saya tulis akurat, benar, confirm, gitu, ya. Kemudian memang lebih apa ya, ini pengalaman lebih pribadi. Saya rasa editor NRC lebih menyukai foto-foto yang simpel justru, ya, simpel sederhana dibanding tanda petik koran atau media di Indonesia. Tapi saya bisa memahami karena koran dan media di Indonesia sebenarnya nggak pernah punya editor foto sampai hari ini, nggak ada itu. Yang betul-betul memiliki editor foto, yang ada foto koordinator itu, tapi itu fungsinya berbeda. NRC kan memiliki editor foto dan tidak hanya satu, ya. Jadi mereka melakukan riset dan memastikan foto yang mereka pilih untuk dipublish tadi mengandung informasi yang akurat, benar. Gitu. Itu pengalaman saya bekerja dengan NRC.
Menambahkan ini, Mas Tamin, Mas Sejara yang mungkin badannya sekarang 25 tahun sesuai itu. Jadi dia mungkin ingin bertanya, jika ada protokol dan kemudian ada laporan, tadi sudah ada menunjukkan bahwa sebuah foto dipilih itu karena ada konsiderasi.
Betul.
Jadi bagaimana itu kita bisa memahami bahwa memang ada koneksi yang kuat antara foto yang tidak hanya sebagai ilustrasi, tapi itu bagian dari reportasi
sendiri. Pertama, memang foto itu harus relevan, ya, relevan terkait dengan berita. Saya tidak pernah foto saya dipakai sebagai ilustrasi, tapi sebagai partner dari teks yang misalnya ditulis Frank, atau kemudian nanti saya lebih banyak bekerja justru dengan penerusnya Frank. Ya, begitu Frank pulang, saya banyak bekerja dengan penggantinya dia. Ketika saya juga sudah mulai full time sebagai fotografer. Sebelumnya ketika saya masih sering gaul dengan Frank, justru saya sebetulnya aktivis dan staff YLBHI. Ini sedikit joke, jadi saya sekolah di teknik sipil, Mas, ITB. Ya. Kemudian masuk YLBHI di bawah Munir ngurusin hak-hak sipil. Jadi dari teknik sipil ke hak-hak sipil. Gak terlalu jauh juga. Nah, selepas Soeharto itu baru saya mulai pelan-pelan menjadi jurnalis, dan ketika Frank pulang sama full ya itu jurnalis. Nah, soal tadi pertama mesti bekerja sama dengan penulis, apa sih yang dia mau ceritain, kemudian kita diskusiin personnya yang mana, kalau misal the most important person in the story gitu ya, dan moment seperti apa yang dicari. Jadi saya mesti bekerja dengan penulis dan editor, ya, berkomunikasi. Problem di Indonesia, saya harap Anda tidak. Kita mostly itu visual illiterate. Gitu. Jadi kebanyakan, bahkan fotografernya sendiri, itu visually illiterate. Jadi kebanyakan suka melihat foto dengan sekedar senang, bagus, pakai jempol. Tapi ketika disuruh membaca, umumnya gagal. Jadi orang lebih memperhatikan aspek estetisnya daripada konten aspek komunikatif dari isi foto.
There's something else about pictures, of course. They can be very sensitive. I showed a picture just now of a dead colleague. At the time that he was killed, this picture was not being published because of the sensitiveness of this, of the fact you could see him there lying. And sorry.
Tadi soal Sanders, ya. Sanders itu teman baiknya Frank. Saya bertemu dengan Sanders sehari sebelum dia berangkat ke Dili, dan kemudian tiba di Dili dua hari kemudian tertembak mati.
I'm sorry, I was a bit emotional because this always happens. But this is the power of photography, that's what I want to say. And it's also now actual happening with the photographs coming from Gaza. And there's lots of discussions on the newspaper about these pictures, about what we show and what we don't show, and what the effect is, and who, with which party do you show the photos of, etc. So the photography has a very direct, big impact on people, much more than text has. So that's a very relevant question.
Yeah.
I'm sorry about this.
It's okay, Frank, I could understand. Jadi, sorry tadi Frank itu kan, Sanders teman baiknya Frank, teman baik kami. Ya. Tadi soal foto, betul kata Frank, ya. Dia memiliki apa efek semua spontanitas langsung ke pembacanya. Nah, problemnya memang harus hati-hati, karena kalau menulis Anda bisa cover both side kan, foto umumnya tunggal, sulit, makanya memang harus hati-hati dalam memilih foto. Ya, kayak foto Sanders tadi lama sekali, tidak ada foto tentang pembunuhan Sanders itu karena itu sensitif. Reaksi pemerintah Indonesia, milisia dan sebagainya, ya, bisa diserang meskipun tidak terkait langsung gitu, ya, hanya karena foto. Oke, ya, semoga menjawab ya.
Yes, oh thanks Frank for sharing your very painful memory. I didn't really understand it. So yeah, fotografi memang memiliki kekuatan seperti itu. Jadi kita juga, teman-teman harus ingat, banyak sekali foto tentang peristiwa sekitar 98 itu yang memang tidak dipublish di mainstream newspaper, termasuk yang kerusuhan, kemudian apa namanya, pemerkosaan massal, kelompok-kelompok Tionghoa. Tapi memang ada lingkaran tertentu yang jaringan yang kemudian itu apa namanya, ada bisa mengakses itu, tapi itu sangat terbatas. Jelas itu tidak akan apa namanya tersebar luas. Tapi kita melihat juga bagaimana misalnya tadi radio itu berperan dalam proses. Jadi kita berbicara bagaimana sebuah gerakan itu kemudian menyatu, bergerak bersama menuju satu tujuan itu semua berpartisipasi sebenarnya. Ada media jelas sangat penting, televisi, tapi radio jangan dilupakan. Itu juga karena radio mungkin ada di semua lini masyarakat, semua orang bisa akses tentang itu, dan newspaper tentu saja yang dengan fotografinya dan seterusnya. Kita simpan dulu yang ini. Ada pertanyaan berikutnya, ya?
Terima kasih Bapak Adi Panjang sudah melakukan presentasi yang sangat komprehensif. Kebetulan saya dalam mata kuliah sejarah kontemporer Indonesia sedang melakukan penelitian jaringan Salafi di Indonesia pasca reformasi. Kebetulan saya dibantu oleh anak-anak di BIN Jakarta. Dalam penelitian saya itu ada sumber menyebutkan ke FPI itu terdiri didukung oleh petinggi-petinggi militer. Menurut Bapak, apakah memang benar FPI pada mulanya itu dibentuk oleh petinggi militer gitu? Terima kasih.
Okay. How do you see it, the root of the
Well, this is one of the things that you cannot be sure about because there are many rumors in a country without a free press. All kinds of stories can get around, and there's no way you can check whether it's true, whether the army is or the rich people's. There was an expression amongst my American colleagues who said when there was a demonstration of civilians brought into Monas Square with buses and said, there's Rent-A-Crowd again. So obviously you could sometimes see that people were paid to demonstrate because they all had the same clothes and they had food with them and buses, etc. But who was paying them or what was behind it, it remained a mystery.
Saya memberikan satu jawaban yang bukan jawaban, tapi lebih pada semacam ada orang bilang menteoretisir atau bahkan itu semacam spekulasi. FPI itu kelanjutan, pertama spekulasi kelanjutan dari apa yang disebut Pam Swakarsa. Waktu itu ada milisia atau kelompok dengan bambu runcing dan sebagainya dari yang menggunakan nama Islam. Kelompok-kelompok Islam yang digunakan untuk melawan gerakan lebih lanjut dari mahasiswa yang menghendaki reformasi total. Reformasi total itu mereka tidak mau menerima Habibie juga. Tapi hari itu dipecah. Nah, Pak Anies ini termasuk yang pecah itu, yang ikut mendukung Habibie bersama kalau kelompok mahasiswanya kami, Kesatuan Aksi Mahasiswa Muslim Indonesia. Nah, itu disupport oleh kelompok dari luar, memang diorganisir oleh militer, kalau itu pasti, namanya, tapi Pam Swakarsa. Nah, pasca itu dilembagakan menjadi FPI. Ada yang bilang begitu. Ya. Dan ini bukan kebenaran, tapi beberapa cara pandang spekulasi atau mencoba menteoritisir fenomena FPI. Kemudian berlanjut, ketika Barat melakukan suatu kampanye anti Islam, ya, the Clash of Civilization, ya, memulai munculnya September 11 teroris, ya, jadi kemudian FPI ditambahin perannya menjadi kelompok paling radikal yang terkendali. Itu katanya dijadikan semacam god parade batas supaya tidak menjadi pengikutnya Ba'asyir, lebih baik jadi pengikut FPI. Gitu. Galak, keras-keras tapi termonitor, karena kalau yang diikut Ba'asyir underground meledak. Jadi FPI adalah god kanal, ya, untuk menerima limpahan energi kelompok-kelompok Islam yang kecewa, gitu, yang menghendaki suatu politik yang lebih Islami. Ini cara pandang yang baik.
Cerita lebih lanjut tentang Pam Swakarsa itu.
Pam Swakarsa itu namanya Pam Swakarsa itu pengamanan Swakarsa swadaya, kayak Hansip lah ya, tapi menggunakan bahasa kayak bagus. Pam Swakarsa itu kelompok-kelompok yang diorganisir tak lama setelah Soeharto mengundurkan diri dan langsung diserahkan kekuasaannya pada Habibie. Kelompok di DPR mulai pecah tuh, kelompok-kelompok yang kami, Anies, Rama dan sebagainya, yang kami tadi M-nya 2 itu mulai mundur dari DPR karena mereka sudah bisa menerima Soeharto mundur, Habibie sebagai penerusnya. Teman-teman yang kayak Forkot, UI dan sebagainya tidak mau, mereka menghendaki reformasi total, ganti semua. Gitu. Nah, sebagai ganti dari kami yang mundur, datanglah mulai mengepung di luar pagar, waktu itu masih namanya Pam Swakarsa itu. Mereka tidak pakai senjata tajam, tapi pakai bambu runcing. Saya sempat terlibat melerai, karena mereka melakukan provokasi, agitasi untuk bentrok fisik. Ya, itu tanggal 22 Mei itu udah keras sekali. Nah, namanya ini Pam Swakarsa, polisi mengakomodir mereka, melindungi mereka. Jadi memang katakan ada satu kelompok entah polisi, entah tentara yang memang mendukung transisi Habibie dan mencoba meredam mahasiswa yang lain tadi dengan ini. Nah, ini sekitar setahunan Pam Swakarsa terlibat sampai ada dalam peristiwa Semanggi 1, Semanggi 2 itu masih terlibat. Setelah itu menghilang karena semakin tidak disukai dan terjadi bentrokan warga besar di Jakarta itu dari Benhil sampai Tanah Abang. Warga yang membela mahasiswa keluar dari kampung bawa golok. Oh, Pam Swakarsa dikejar-kejar. Itu terjadi korban jiwa tidak sampai mati. Ya. Tapi mahasiswa disupport oleh masyarakat Benhil sampai Tanah Abang mengejar Pam Swakarsa. Nah, mereka bukan anak lokal, kebanyakan dari Cilegon, Serang, Cikampek, gitu ya, anak-anak luar kota yang dimobilisasi dan diberitahu mahasiswa komunis. Yang mereka yang minta Habibie turun itu komunis. Nah, mereka marah kan? Gitu. Jadi ini mereka diperalat, dibayar pasti karena ada unsur mobilisasi, makanannya tuh kotaknya bagus-bagus gitu ya. Kelihatan lah ada yang ngedrop, ada yang organisir. Nah, kelompok ini yang kemudian nanti, dan ini saya rasa sudah sejarah sebetulnya menulis ya. Kan ini penting bagaimana negara, aparatus ya, selalu menggunakan unsur masyarakat untuk sebenarnya juga menggunakan politik belah bambu, adu domba, ya, itu jelas. Saya yakin kalau itu, ya, tapi tadi keyakinan saya lebih pada melihat realita dan analisa politiknya, bukan berdasarkan pada satu truth kebenaran, karena belum bisa dikonfirmasi seperti kata Frank, ya, begitu banyak kepercayaan, rumor, ya, gitu. Paling kita gitu, duga-duga, ya. Dan ini yang nanti kemudian bermuara di Tanah Abang dipimpin oleh Rizik menjadi front pembela Islam, terutama ini digunakan betul untuk melawan Gus Dur, karena waktu itu Gus Dur berusaha betul juga menekan militer kan untuk keluar dari panggung politik, sementara kelompok-kelompok yang pro tentara militer apa politik ini menciptakan kerusuhan di mana-mana, Ambon, ya, Kuda Tuli, bukan Kuda Tuli, peristiwa apa Dukun Santet di Jawa Timur gitu ya. Di mana terjadi kekerasan-kekerasan menuntut korban jiwa, puncaknya di Ambon. Sehingga memang mau enggak mau Gus Dur jadi butuh tentara kan untuk menstabilkan. Nah, mereka menggunakan Habib Rizieq ini demo gila-gilaan. Dia bawa pedang, ngacungin pedang ke istana, ribuan orang. Tapi itu saya melihatnya langsung. Gus Dur tahu, dan Gus Dur tidak mau ngambil jalan konfrontasi. Karena Ansor waktu itu udah marah banget sama Banser. Kalau Gus Dur tipe tukang kelahi, ya, dilibas cepat. Tapi itu kan jadinya berdarah-darah kita. Gus Dur bukan tipe seperti itu, dia seorang demokrat betul. Dan dari situ muncul kepercayaan lebih kuat, memang ada kelompok di dalam militer, intelijen yang membina atau mendalami FPI. Tapi itu tadi tugas Anda nih sebagai historian meneliti. Kita butuh loh hal-hal begini menjadi jelas, terutama untuk mengakhiri praktek-praktek serupa. Ya, seringkali masyarakat kita diadu domba, yang mengadu domba mereka yang butuh kita kelahi.
Oke, terima kasih Mas Deddy. Jadi teman-teman, turunnya Pak Harto di Mei 98 itu bukan akhir dari sebuah proses politik. Ia menjadi awal dari proses politik yang lain yang agak sedikit berbeda. Tapi memang dalam beberapa hal juga nuansanya juga tidak kalah apa namanya penting untuk dipahami semuanya. Jadi ada banyak hal yang apa namanya juga harus kita pahami pasca mundurnya Pak Harto kayak gitu. Oke, kita masih punya waktu sekitar ya 10 menitan lah kayak gitu. Kalau misalnya ada pertanyaan lagi, Nanim, satu lagi. Oke, Mas.
Sebelumnya terima kasih atas kesempatan yang diberikan. Saya akan memberikan pengantar lebih dulu mengenai Pak Denny yang tadi bilang mengenai tentang Cak Nur dan Gus Dur. Jadi saya teringat itu bahwasannya Soeharto itu memilih Tengser ke Prambon, Mandek Padito ikuti Raja Jawa. Dan sebelumnya pada tanggal 19 Mei 9 tokoh itu diundang, antara lain Gus Dur, Cak Nur, Cak Nun, dan Pak Ma'ruf Amin dan lain-lain. Nah, saya pertanyaannya ialah bagaimana point of view dari seorang jurnalis Mr. Frank dan Pak Dini. Terima kasih.
I think Gus Dur was one of the most fascinating and interesting political figures, meanwhile also a religious figure in that period. My comment on what happened that day is, I think he was always trying to support ideas that could bring a peaceful solution. And of course, you do not know what has been said inside the room. Were there threats? I mean, if Renato was also in the room, which is probable, he might have said, "If you don't get him out, I will kick him out," because he also let him in. And I left that out of the story because I had to be concise in this story, but. If you're a correspondent, you think there's a revolution going on. People call it a reformatie, but in the Dutch context means something different actually, because it's something that happened 300 years ago when the Dutch opposed the Spaniards who were then rulers of Holland. There was a reformatie, they changed from Catholics into Protestants. It was also a revolution. And you see fire, you see people on the streets, you see fighting, and meanwhile you also see all these buildings. After a few days, the lights are on, the water is still running from the taps, everything is still working. So is this a revolution, or are you looking at a big stage set by someone? And afterwards, maybe it was Wiranto who was letting the students in, giving Suharto a sign, time to go, and meanwhile supporting Suharto, of course, because he was in between the situation and inside the chamber with Suharto and Gusdur. It's possible that he might have said, and this end of story. But of course, he also knew what was happening in the cabinet. All the ministers were already, they were gone. So it was too late, too little too late. And he knew it, I think.
Okay, saya sudah beberapa pertama betul kata Frank. Kita tidak tahu persis apa yang mereka bicarakan karena tidak ada yang membocorkan. Even mereka semua tidak ada yang ngomong apa sebenarnya dibocorkan. Kecuali mereka mengatakan Pak Harto berjanji untuk melakukan perbaikan. Kurang lebih semacam itu. Tapi Anda bisa cek persis perbatinnya gimana. Gus Dur kepada kami di Forum Demokrasi juga memberikan informasi yang serupa. Pak Harto siap ngalah. Pakai bahasa Jawa, siap kalah. Gitu. Tapi banyak elemen di dalam Forum Demokrasi yang nggak mau. Udah tahu kok seperti kata Fred, menteri udah mundur, ini soal waktu aja. Nih. Nah, tapi di sini juga inilah Gus Dur. Gus Dur itu orang yang betul-betul sekali lagi sangat mencintai jalan damai. Ya, ada kekerasan. Sehingga dia memang khawatir kalau seperti Frank, Wiranto atau apapun sebenarnya mengancam untuk membersihkan. Karena waktu itu udah muncul rumor, katanya udah ratusan kantong mayat segala disiapkan untuk menyerbu ke gedung DPR MPR. Rumor seperti itu hampir setiap hari. Ya, itu yang harus kami lawan juga. Ya, tapi Gus Dur tadi Pak Harto siapa lah? Saya terutama yang muda di dalam Forum Demokrasi bandel nggak mau dong, ya kan? Lanjut. Gus Dur suatu siang persis tanggal 21 saya ingat ngirim anaknya Yeni kepada saya maki-maki karena dia minta mas ajak itu adik-adik keluar, kalau kamu mau kamu masuk aja sana sendiri ajak mereka keluar, aku nggak kenal lah aku bukan mahasiswa berarti ya, saking marahnya saya gitu. Tapi betul itu siang sekitar jam 1 ya Yeni datang ke saya dan minta bapak mesen mas tolong kasihan adik-adik itu kalau nanti di nah Yeni memang bilang ditembaki tentara. Tapi kembali lagi itu karena Gus Dur memang orang yang anti kekerasan seperti saya bilang kalau buat dia Habib Rizik FPI kecil ya nggak ada apa-apanya kalau Gus Dur mau menggunakan fisik ya kekuatan NU gitu untuk menebas FPI recehan lah istilahnya. Tapi Gus Dur bukan tipe itu. Ya, saya tahu betul itu. Ya. Dia enggak. Sama seperti Mei tanggal 19 itu ya, Gus Dur minta adik-adik, ayo mau adik-adik diajak pulang ke dia mau begitu, Pak Harto siapa mana. Terus dia harus pergi lagi. Nah, saya ditanyain main-main gimana? Enggak, biarin aja mereka di sana. Karena kita belum tahu kan, tahan mundur atau enggak, baru besok paginya dia melanjutkan kabar tadi Bapak Harto siap. Jadi kita enggak tahu persis lah apa yang mungkin bisa ancaman, ya memang Gus Dur sangat peduli dengan kita waktu itu. Dan bisa juga memang hanya karena dia percaya Pak Harto akan mundur, kok menteri-menterinya sudah selesai sebetulnya, sudah lemdak. Tentara pecah, Gus Dur tahu pasti itu. Ya. Menteri-menteri udah kabinet udah bubar.
Baik, sebelumnya terima kasih kepada Mr. Frank dan Pak Denny
izin bertanya khususnya tentang isu aktivisme mahasiswa di kala itu ya. Jadi ketika mahasiswa dan rakyat bergerak untuk menjatuhkan Pak Soeharto, apakah dari pemerintah sendiri ada campur tangan lewat intelijennya untuk memecah dari gerakan mahasiswa dan rakyat itu sendiri? Karena pada hari ini juga aliansi mahasiswa sudah terbelah, apalagi di kala itu gitu Pak. Terima kasih.
Oke, saya akan menjawab. Intel pasti mas, pasti. Intel itu dua, satu masuk memecah belah dengan isu rumor dan semacam. Kedua memprovokasi. Jadi ini salah satu peristiwa yang paling hebat itu ada satu mahasiswa UI naik mobil safari nabrak barikade polisi. Ya. Itu sebelum kejadian saya persis di depannya. Itu ada sekitar 10 pengendara naik trail, helm ditutup, ngegas. Tiba-tiba ke arah mahasiswa muter balik, mereka yang menabrak polisi. Ya, polisi langsung marah dong. Yang diserang siapa? Ya yang di depannya, tiga mahasiswa karena yang lain terlalu gak menggila. Mereka sering memasukkan agen provokator karena memang mau meringkus mahasiswa. Jadi masuk nih bentrok ada depan-depan, baru otot-ototan mereka masuk, mereka nendang, pukul, melempar dari balik mahasiswa. Nah, terus mahasiswanya diajar. Itu saya menjadi saksi. Saya bertahun-tahun jadi aktivis. Saya sampai latihan mas nyiapin adik-adik itu waktu itu bagaimana mengatasinya begini-begini. Saya belajar ke Korea, ke Thailand, bagaimana gerakan mahasiswa sana ngadepin agen provokator. Waktu itu 98 saya sempat melatih beberapa teman untuk itu, tapi keburu sebelum matang udah pecah duluan lah. Itu Intel itu wah gila, mereka pelakunya. Jadi yang membakar, yang melempar itu mereka supaya ada alasan untuk gebuk mahasiswanya. Sama kemarin yang waktu aksi reformasi di korupsi yang bakar halte kan mereka juga. Ya toh muncul di media footage-nya. Kita bersyukur tuh Anies mau membocorkan footage-nya Pemda itu sehingga media memiliki orang-orang itu di Jogja juga kan itu di dekat Malioboro yang lempar terus bakar-bakar kemudian mahasiswa yang disalahin. Pelakunya mereka. Ini lucu sebenarnya. Di Amerika ada gerakan anti komunis McCarthy, ya. Mereka sengaja menyusupkan agen-agen apa yang disebut causability, alasan pembenar. Ya. Jadi kalau Anda di situ Anda melempar saya maka hak sah saya untuk memukul. Padahal yang melempar adalah agen yang memang dimasukkan untuk melempar supaya bisa dikebuk. Nah, wartawan kesulitan. Nah, waktu reformasi di korupsi itu bagus banget karena Pemda DKI Anies mau membocorkan rekaman-rekaman di Transjakarta itu ke media. Aiman bagus sekali menyusun itu, ngedit itu. Ya, ketahuan ternyata pelakunya adalah ya itu aja berseragam.
I have done some thinking. There's always the question about movements. Are they moving themselves or are they being moved? And then if I may say something about Indonesian history as a journalist, as a reader, we can see that starting from 1945, there was a youth movement that started a revolution, had succeeded to independence declaration by Suharto and Hatta. I'm getting tired of it. Or retired. Retard. Sukarno and the youngsters, they took him to Pekalongan, not to Rangkast Bengklok. Yeah. And they were pressured to declare independence. Of course, they fought in the war. And since then, I've got the impression that now and again, new generations want to replay the revolution. So they did it in 40, 45, 49, they did it in between 65 and 70, and then they did it again in 98. And but still the question remains, what was behind those movements? Were these students steering themselves, or are they being used? It's something to think about.
Oke, saya tambahkan ini. Saya jadi tertarik lagi karena Frank ngomong gitu. Ada politik bahasa. Ya, ada satu istilah yang khas namanya ditunggangi. Ya, jadi digerakkan untuk dimanfaatkan dalam politik. Jadi selalu tidak pernah dianggap bahwa itu gerakan yang murni atau genuine. Gitu. Selalu ada yang membayar, ada dalang, ada yang menunggangi. Ini terutama di era Orde Baru yang memang anti politik, apapun dibilang ditunggangi. Nah ini terus ke bawah sampai sekarang. Mudah sekali untuk orang-orang menjadi kehilangan simpati, mereka tidak genuine, gitu. Mereka ditunggangi, mereka pasukan nasi bungkus, ada yang bayarin dan sebagainya. Itu justru berbahaya menurut saya, karena sebenarnya itu irrelevan, tapi kita jadi fokus ke situ. Kan seharusnya relevan atau tidak adalah isunya apa yang diperjuangkan. Gak penting itu yang memperjuangkan siapa, bayaran apa, karena memang isunya penting relevan untuk publik, mesti kita support kan. Kan kita dialihkan, distracting pada ditunggangi mastermind dalam dari gerakan.
Oke, sebenarnya masih sangat banyak mungkin ya hal yang bisa didiskusikan. Kita sudah mendengar dari sesi tanya jawab ini pop up banyak hal, banyak dimensi dari 98. Jadi kita melihat bahwa proses ini adalah sebuah proses historis yang memang selalu sangat kompleks gitu kan. Jadi kita pun ini bisa dijadikan sebagai agenda buat teman-teman untuk ke penelitian, buat skripsi, buat tesis atau apapun. Jadi tadi Pak Frank sudah menjelaskan perspektif beliau sebagai jurnalis dan kemudian bagaimana kerja jurnalistiknya selama periode ini. Kita juga mendapatkan informasinya yang sangat menarik dan berharga dari Mas Denny sebagai aktivis juga yang saksi langsung dari proses-proses yang terjadi pada waktu itu. Ya sayangnya kita memang harus berhenti karena waktu. Nanti jam 11 ada acara yang lain yang akan menggunakan ruangan ini. Jadi mari kita berikan applause yang sebesar Frank, thank you so much for your lecture and also for sharing your experience with our students. It's a good honor to us. Thank you so much. Terima kasih juga Mas Denny atas sharingnya. Semoga kita ada kesempatan lagi di next time. Maybe when your book is coming out, then you can also launch in our department if you like. So yeah, then we'll have another.
Nanti kalau dipakai kapan pun kalian pengen datang ngobrol.
Silakan. Nah itu. Jadi Mas Denny.
Orang yang jauh dia tinggal di Belanda. Tapi bagus juga kalau Anda mau ke sana.
Oke, okay, terima kasih semuanya. Terima kasih lagi sekali lagi Frank, Denny. Kita bertemu lagi di lain kesempatan. Terima kasih semuanya sudah hadir. Kita tutup bersama acara kita hari ini dengan applause bersama-sama ya. Mau ada photo session enggak, Mas Frank? Oke, okay. Untuk menutup seperti biasa ada photo session. Oh ya, yeah, forget. We got something, right? I'm sure. Maybe untuk Pak Denny nanti menyusul ya. Ini buat kita yang jauh. Sedikit oleh-oleh sebagai token of appreciation. Terima kasih kami. Terima kasih. Frank cuma diterima. It's just, you know, book and semua merchandise. Ya, silakan kalau mau potong, silakan. Teman-teman.